Welcome to this week's episode of the Punk Popcast, where we're going to talk about Fallout Boys from Under the Cork Tree. Welcome to this week's episode of the Punk Popcast. As always, I am Brad, and I'm joined by our guy on my left, joined by Jason. How are you doing today, Jason?
I'm doing fantastic. How are you doing today?
Excellent. I am doing very well. Thank you very much for asking. All right. So this week, we're going to get into one of my favorite albums ever. It didn't make my top three because it's not quite there, but I would probably put it top 10 of like overall albums. But anyway, that is Fall Out Boys from Under the Cork Tree. So Jason, you and I have had conversation about this outside of the podcast. We talked about it a little bit in last week's episode. Just some of the lyrics that were tied into that album. I mean, I think we can both agree this is just outstanding, just flat out outstanding from start to finish, right?
Oh, definitely. And then I had the tour version. What was it? The Underdogs and I forget the total name of the tour version of the album, but it had the extra songs like Snitches and Talkers Get Stitches and Walkers, and the demo of oh my god, I need to pull up everything.
It's got the demo of My Heart Is the Worst Kind of Weapon.
Yep.
There's two remixes. There's a remix of Sugar We're Going Down, and then there's another remix of Dance Dance.
That was not on that version of the album I had.
Oh really?
Yeah, because mine was like a special tour edition.
Yeah, that's so I have it pulled up. I had the tour edition as well because I bought this album twice. I bought the original iteration when it first came out, and then when the tour edition came out, I was like, well, I gotta have it, so I bought it again.
I had a burned copy, and then I had the tour edition. So.
Yeah, so well, and the thing too is that like is that I think I talked about this last time about how my friends didn't listen to Fall Out Boy with me, and I was the only one of my group of friends. But then Sugar We're Going Down comes out, and my buddy texts me. He's like, dude, Fall Out Boy rocks. I'm like, I've been telling you for 3 years.
I can remember being in the Lincoln Continental that the bass player in my band drove, listening to the burned copy. And he's like, oh my god, he's mumbling worse on this album than he was on the first one. And another thing I remember about this album was all the conspiracy theories about the lyrics and the song titles. And
yeah,
MySpace was all a flutter about figuring out what the songs were about and who they were about and what the titles meant. And it was a fun time to be alive in 2005.
I'm sure it was. Well, speaking of the song titles, though, we got on this a little bit last week because we see it a little bit on Take This to Your Grave, but the song titles are rampant on this album, like out of control, just the length on them. Like, let's go through a few of them. Like, I mean, the first track, Our Lawyer Made Us Change the Name of the Song So We Wouldn't Get Sued. There's that. We're going to get to I've Got a Dark Alley and a Bad Idea That Says You Should Shut Your Mouth. Champagne for My Real Friends, Real Pain for My Sham Friends. And it just goes on. Get Busy Living or Get Busy Dying. Parenthetical, do your part to save the scene and stop going to shows. Like, now these don't even fit on the infotainment screen in your car. Like, there's no way you could know what the name of these songs are.
I love that. I really love the original name to Our Lawyer Made Us Change the Names of This Song So We Wouldn't Get Sued. Because I'm a music nerd. I mean, like, beyond pop punk, I'm a big music nerd. And I love the fact that the original title was My Name is David Ruffin and These Are the Temptations. Like, that's such a great name. And it's such like a snotty pop punk name. Like, and I understood why they had to change it, but...
Yeah. But, and this is the thing that I find funny too, is like getting into later albums that I'm surprised they haven't had this issue more, because from Infinity on High, there was Thriller was the name of the first song. And I was like, oh, sweet. They're going to lead off with a Thriller cover. No, it's just, that's what they called the song. And there's another one. I think it's on Save Rock and Roll. The Kids Aren't All Right. That's an Offspring song. And I know there's songs like throughout history where people have used the same title, but those are very specific. You know, It's almost like I do SEO. I do SEO as part of my job. It's almost like they were like still choosing their song titles based on like peer to peer sharing platforms, you know.
The Kids Aren't All Right was on American Beauty, American Psycho.
Okay. Yeah, that's right. That's right. I knew it was on one of those later albums, but I couldn't remember which one for sure. But anyway, let's go ahead. Should we go ahead and get into this?
I think we should.
We got a lot to cover. Got a whole lot to cover. Let's start with the first single off this album. Let's just start with Sugar, We're Going Down. So this is, honestly, this song, I had a buddy who I was listening, like I was in a car, there was like four of us in this car, and we were listening to the album. And I was singing along. He's like, what? What did, you know, it's classic Fall Out Boy. What did you say? Like, it was in the chorus. A loaded God complex, cock it and pull it. He's like, that doesn't even make sense. I was like, he's like, there's no way that's the words. I was like, I guarantee you 100% those are the words. I read it out of the CD jacket. He's like, well, it just doesn't make sense. I was like, I know it doesn't make sense, but those are the words. Like, come on, man. But no, that was one of my first experiences with this album.
A lot of, you know, it's a Fall Out Boy song when there's voyeurism involved.
Yes. Yes. Especially when, like we talked about last time, about how this could be a sequel to Grand Theft Autumn, and specifically tying the video into the song, right?
Right, right.
Yeah. That, I think you're right, and it's a very Fall Out Boy thing to do.
Very Pete Wentz is to,
yeah, to be a voyeur. There's a thread through everything with Pete Wentz. Let's be honest. Like, that's the way he does things. And it's great and it's fun, but everything is tied together. Like, the first song on Take This to Your Grave, I guarantee you, is tied some way to the last song on Mania. I guarantee you.
He's you know, he is legitimately a lyrical genius. That's not hyperbole on my part.
Yeah.
The line that always stuck out for me is, I'm just a notch on your bedpost and you're just a line in a song.
Such a good line.
It's such a good line. It's such an emo line. And it's so bitter.
Mm-hmm. But let's be honest, Jason, like, would you rather be a notch on the bedpost or would you rather be a line in a song? Because one's immortalized, the other one's going to the trash heap at some point.
Wow.
I'm just saying.
I guess the notch in the bedpost would be less memorable. So.
Yeah.
Threw me a curveball on that one.
Food for thought. How about that?
So, oh, man.
But anyway, no, here's one of the things about this song is that, like, it came out and I thought it was probably the weakest song on the entire album. I was like, it, which, don't get me wrong, it, as the kids say, it slaps. Do the kids still say that? I don't know. But anyway, it is a great song. It's a fun listen and everything. And it changed the landscape of the radio. Like, we had Blink-182 and we had Green Day. And to some extent, All American Rejects playing on the radio, but there was nothing that sounded like this. And part of the problem that they had, even before they got on with Island, was that record labels were like, those guitars are way too heavy. It's not going to appeal to the public. It's not going to do well on the radio. But this song hit hard on the radio, and everybody loved it.
It was a solid mix of punk and pop.
Yes. Yes, exactly. Like, we've talked before that people consider Best of Me like the quintessential best pop-punk song ever. But this might be the one. Because it brought so many people together into the genre. And then later ended up being almost the demise of the genre. But we'll get to that. that's my opinion. But we'll get to that.
Before we move on from this song, I want to throw something out there just because I've re-listened to this multiple times leading up to this episode. Mm-hmm. This might be the best album drumming-wise for Andy Hurley.
Oh, yes. 100%. I agree with you. Yeah. It's outstanding. I had a buddy I was listening to this album with, and he's into rap. Wasn't really into pop punk until I met him, but we were sitting here listening to this album, and he's like, this is like really good drumming. It is.
It is. It is fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And on that note, let's go to one of my favorite songs as far as bass lines and drum lines go. Let's talk about Dance Dance. I don't know about you, Jason, but I was hooked the opening bass line of this song.
The opening bass line draws you in. This plays back to our favorite things of the genres. You like the music, I love the lyrics. This is one of my favorite songs lyrically of the genre.
And I would agree with that. Because, like I said, the bass line drew me in, but the lyrics kept me. Right? So, I don't know. And this was the second single, so I do feel like it plays a really big part in the success of this album. But this was the song that I listened to on repeat when I first got it. Because I couldn't get enough of the bass solo, because I'm a sucker for a good bass solo, let's be real.
Speaking of bass, odd thought I've had, and I've talked about this with Jamie a lot of times. Do you ever notice that when the bass player is the driving force of the band, he pretty much does everything the lead singer should do except for sing?
Yeah.
Like Pete Wentz, it introduces all the songs. He does all of the press. He does this. He does that. And like, bring it back to Motley Crue, one of my old time favorite bands. Nikki Sixx does all the press, does all the interviews, does a lot of the talking at the concerts.
Yeah. Well, and you know, I do think it's cool. And before I get too deep into that, there's something about that too. I feel like there's a specific feel that the band has when that's the case. And it's a little bit different than everybody else. Right. I've always thought that like bass players are just like, I don't want to say a little bit off, but they're a little bit different than everybody else. And I don't know what it is, but like Pete Wentz obviously is a little bit different than Pat Stump. I remember reading something about the bass player from Simple Plan one time. I'm like, this dude is weird. You know, something about bass players. I don't know. But as far as Fall Out Boy goes, that, Patrick Stump is, you know, obviously the lead singer, and he has always considered himself, from what I've read, as kind of a shy guy. That he's not somebody who loves the limelight. He likes to sing, likes to play guitar, obviously. But he has said that he's been fine with the role that Pete Wentz has taken as far as like the front man, quote unquote, the front man of the band, and being the guy who brings in all the attention, right? That he's okay with the spotlight kind of shifting over to Pete Wentz while he can kind of do his job. So I think that's pretty cool. I've always thought that's cool. But one thing I love about this song, did you ever see the music video for this song, Jason?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my. And, like, it's typical Fall Out Boy funny. You know, like, there's the humor in it. But when they're actually playing on the stage, like, some of the moves that they do, like, there's one where Patrick Stump bends over to play his guitar and Pete Wentz does, like, a barrel roll over him.
Yes.
You know what part I'm talking about? I remember seeing that and just being like, oh my gosh, it's awesome. It was so cool.
Going back to the lyrics on this song, I always loved the bridge of "Why don't you show me a little bit of spine you've been saving for his mattress? I only want sympathy in the form of you crawling into bed with me." This is a really desperate song.
It is. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it really is a desperate song. That's a great line. I absolutely agree with you. I love it. And one thing that's, before we move on, one thing that is funny about this song to me is that my buddy, the same one who I introduced to Fall Out Boy with this album, he used this as like a whatever. Like he used Dance Dance as like a whatever. He's like, what? Just Dance Dance. Just Dance Dance. just Dance Dance. Whatever. But all right, so we talked about the two singles. I think, and honestly, I don't know that we could even do those justice, because Dance Dance to me is such a great song that if we didn't include it as like our overall overarching like conversation, it would have ended up there anyway for me. So
it's a seminal song off the album. So
it is. Yep. All right, Jason, go ahead with your first one. What's your first track that you want to talk about?
Oh man, throwing me out there to the wolves. let's go
as
with
per get, usual.
Let's go with Get Busy Living or Get Busy Dying. Parenthetical, do your part to save the scene and stop going to shows. And boy, that takes up the entire ticker on the bottom of the screen.
It does. I was going to say that same thing.
So before leading up to this, we had talked and I just could not hammer home a third song because I like so many of the songs. And then I re-listened to this one actually today, and I'm like, this is the one I want to talk about because the lyrics are so phenomenal and they're so spot on to emo pop punk guys from that time period. Mm-hmm. What from the get-go, one of the lines that stood out to me was, "I'm falling apart, the songs about hips and hearts." How many songs from that time period in this genre spoke about hips and hearts? It was common.
Yeah. It is. I don't know. This was one of the songs that, like, I don't know if it was because of the outro part where Pete Wentz is like, from day one, I talked about getting out. Like, that part, like, it's fine. Like, it's really well written. It's like typical Pete Wentz, but like,
yes,
this was the song on the album that I always like struggled with, you know, and part of it was the melody a little bit, but at the same time, like, if I'm listening to the album, I'm not going to skip it. You know, like I used to, but it's gotten to the point where I'm like, I get it. I understand it more now that I've listened to it more and I understand more Fall Out Boy. But if I had to pick a weak song on the album, this for me, this would be the one. However, that being said, it is lyrically, of course, outstanding. It is very good. And I think part of it for me from the beginning was the kind of the cadence of things. You know, like at the beginning, it's like, this has been said so many times that before that I'm not sure if it matters, you know. I had a hard time like getting into it.
Yeah. And you know what though, when I first got the album, it was a tough one to get into because of that. And I agree. But the more and more I listen to it, the more and more I'm like, this is a really good song. Lyrically, this is a really strong song. Mm-hmm. And it's really Pete exercising his demons about that whole scene of music.
Yeah, it is. Especially the second verse where it's, but it must be said again that all us boys are just screaming into microphones for attention because we're just so bored.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, 100%.
And full on this album's innuendo, that bridge where they're yelling, "Tell me you like boys like me better in the dark lying on top of you." Pete just was all over this album with that stuff.
I don't know that would even be innuendo as it would be.
That's just up front. Again, desperation is a theme in this album.
Yeah, it is. And it, which is funny because it doesn't have the same cutting lines that, I mean, there are some, but not as many cutting lines as are in Take This to Your Grave, because that's what that specifically is about. But it might be more along the lines of like, it might be like the closure side of things, right? Like Take This to Your Grave was the anger side and this is the acceptance or the, I don't know, all the phases of what, I don't even know what it's called right now, of mourning or whatever. But this, I don't know, it's definitely a different phase, but it could all be about the same girl.
Or Michelle Trachtenberg.
Or Michelle Trachtenberg. To each their own.
And he talked about it on Howard, so.
But anyway, no, I think I did, like I said, as I've gotten more, I guess, more mature and more familiar with Fall Out Boy style, this is a song that to me has, I've grown like a ton with appreciation. I like it a lot more than I originally did. So. Good choice though, because it does, to me, it could be one of those polarizing songs on the album. So I think it's a great choice. I'm gonna go with course here a little bit, and I'm gonna go with The Music or the Misery. So for those of you who did not get the tour edition, you may not have ever heard this song. However, it's fantastic. It's a great song. The beginning of this song actually hits I feel like it's used in the intro of another song somewhere down the line. because when I bought this, I was like, I wonder if Fall Out Boy is going to be, if this is the direction they're going to be going. But then I found out they recorded like 26 songs for the album. And then they chose the original 12 or whatever, 12 or 13 that they used. And this just happened, this one and Snitches and Talkers Get Stitches and Walkers. Like that was the other one that, that they didn't use and they chose to put on here. But anyway, I always thought this was funny. So like I said, this song is called The Music of the Misery. There is Snitches and Talkers Get Stitches and Walkers. I was always confused by the first line of the song. I got my stitches stitched. I'm like, wait a minute. Is that
same here
supposed to be? But then, you know, you go on and listen to it. And it all comes together with the chorus, you know, goes into which came first, the music or the misery. More desperation by Pete Wentz? Question mark.
That and a really good movie reference. I don't know if you've ever seen the movie High Fidelity.
No, I haven't. I've been told I need to see it.
It's a great John Cusack film. Not giving away a lot of spoilers, but he gets broken up with and he gets like depressed and is listening to music. And he has this soliloquy about pop music and were teenagers miserable because they were broken up with, or were they miserable because they were listening to pop music? Hence, he says, which came first, the music or the misery?
That makes a whole lot of sense. I like that. That's really good. Another line that I like, it's true romance is dead. I shot it in the chest then in the head.
That is such a great line. It is a fantastic line.
Yes, it is. I love it. It's outstanding. Yeah, I mean, I can't even like fully fathom like what he's going through there, but the poetry of it and the imagery is like, oof,
yeah.
Yep.
I always liked it. I got your love letters and corrected the grammar and sent them back. Like, that's so hilarious.
And you know what? I'll be honest with you. With somebody who reads emails from people, reads text messages from people, but is also like habitually like fat fingered when texting and leaving words out because my brain's moving faster than my hands. Like, I do this. I don't send them back, but I proofread everything. And it's kind of a curse because I'm a writer professionally, you know, so it's something that I look for. But at the same time, like, there are times I'm just like, that's wrong. And I would love to send it back.
Pete would not have liked reading Prince's lyrics, that's for sure.
Well, and you know what's funny too is that, like, speaking of lyrics that are grammatically incorrect, like, I do that all the time with the Frozen lyrics.
Oh, no.
There are a lot of grammatical errors with those songs from Frozen, and it drives me insane. Like, they're catchy, don't get me wrong. And it's mostly the melody and the tune and everything, but there are a lot of grammatical errors, and I have a hard time not bringing it up in our house. So I get it. And it's funny. It is a great line. It's really good. But let's go ahead. Hey, Jason, we've got four left. Let's go ahead and take a break. That way
sounds,
we can
kind
of even things out. And one of us isn't left hanging, carrying the brunt of things for the second half. So we'll take a quick break. We'll get back. We have four songs left to go through.
9+Us presents the Baseball Together podcast with your hosts, Blackjack Brad and Kansas City Little Big Briggy Blue Eyes. Weekly episodes for the entire baseball family where we talk all baseball all the time. Available on all your favorite podcast apps and on YouTube. Come join our baseball family where we do baseball together.
I'm Jason.
And I'm David. And we're the hosts of the Non-Nor Sports Podcast. We're the home of sports talk for everyone. Join us bi-weekly as we talk about the happenings in sports.
You can find the Non-Nor Sports Podcast on anchor.fm, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, and wherever else you find your podcasts.
Welcome back to the Punk Popcast. We have four songs left on From Under the Cork Tree to talk about. And quite honestly, we could have spent an hour, hour and a half, maybe even 2 hours talking about the entire album together. Collectively, we're going to be hitting almost half, which is kind of against what we typically do. But here we are. So Jason, go ahead with your next song.
Well, before I continue, for those of you watching on YouTube, I realized that no one was wearing a trucker cap like Patrick wore on this album. So I threw on a trucker cap. in honor of Patrick. Okay, so my next song is going to be Sophomore Slump or Comeback of the Year. So when I first got this album, this was a song that pulled me in right away and was a quick favorite of mine. Musically, it hits. Lyrically, it hits. It's a phenomenal song. And there's a part of me that kind of secretly wishes it would have been a single.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It would have done well. Would have done really well.
I think
well.
So.
Yeah.
Because it has that stadium anthem vibe to it. And I just hit my microphone. Sorry.
It does. It has a really good build to it. I mean, starting out with the mellow chorus, then going into the verse, and then back into the same chorus, but it's bigger. It's a lot bigger than what it was initially. And that chorus, by the way, is outstanding. I feel like a lot of us can relate to it. Are we growing up or just going down? It's just a matter of time until we're all found out. Take our tears and put them on ice, because I swear I'd burn the city down to show you the light. Like, imagery, outstanding, phrasing, perfect, and it gets together. It puts across a great message of, like, to me, it's like a feeling of inadequacy and trying to convey that message to somebody, but they just don't get it.
And I think that's something Fall Out Boy does really well in a lot of their songs, is that underdog feeling. Like, you listen to it and you know you're not alone. Like, mm-hmm. you're not the only person who's feeling like this. Like, in verse two, I love the lines, we're the kids you used to love, but then we grew old. We're the lifers here till the bitter end, condemned from the start. Like, I understood that line when I was 21, you know? Like, I got it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yep. And in the beginning of that verse, we're traveled like gypsies, only with worse luck and far less gold. Yeah, I always thought that was a funny line.
And it's such a perfect Fall Out Boy line too. Like, we talk about Bowling for Soup being a comedy band, but then they have some serious songs. Like, Fall Out Boy always works in some kind of sly, humorous line that it'll go over your head for like a few times, and like a Kevin Smith film, you watch it for like the 37th time and then you pick up on it and you're never forgetting it.
or sometimes you do catch it the first time, like the Volkswagen reference. But yes. But anyway, no, this is a great song. This one is one that I've always liked, and it has like a perfect, and one of the reasons I think it would have done well is because it has a perfect poppy beat.
Yes.
But at the same time, it has the Fall Out Boy like heavy guitars that draw in the people who love that aspect of it. So great one. Yeah, anyway, all right, very good. I love it. Was there anything else you wanted to address with that song?
I'm good.
Okay, perfect. Let's go on to, this is another one I love, 7 Minutes in Heaven, parenthetical, out of Van Halen. So this one I always thought was interesting, the way, like, the title to me was interesting because at the time I did not know what Ativan was, but as I've gotten older, and obviously, I mean, I worked in pharmacy for like 6 years, so like 5 or 6 years, so definitely familiar with Ativan at this point in time. And it actually makes perfect sense to me. The title is actually really fitting with the lyrics, which kind of goes against the grain a little bit here with the rest of this album at face value. But I mean, the first verse starts out, I'm sleeping my way out of this one with anyone who will lie down. I'll be stuck fixated on one star when the world is crashing down. That to me is I mean, that's grieving.
Yeah,
right? And 7 Minutes in Heaven, I mean, that's basically a one night stand. And then Ada Van Halen, obviously they have reference to Van Halen, but Ativan, for those of you who don't know, is an anti-anxiety medication that apparently Pete Wentz really struggled with for a long time, that he was addicted to it and really struggled. But I mean, anybody who's ever gone through the grieving process, something like that could help, you know, helps with some of the anxiety and things like that. And so it really is heavy the way that it all comes together. There's a lot more layers to this song than just like the awesome guitars and the catchy beat, you know?
No, there is. And this song, and I'll be talking about the song before it next, they almost kind of go hand in hand because of what they deal with. Because they deal with Pete's struggles with mental health and emotional health and whatnot. So it is, for such a lighthearted sounding song, it's a darker song lyrically.
Mm-hmm. It is. Yeah. Well, and I mean, you talked about it wouldn't be a Fall Out Boy song if there wasn't voyeurism involved. The chorus. I keep telling myself I'm not the desperate type, but you've got me looking in through blinds. It spells it out for you right there.
You know, and we're totally ignoring the fact that that Brandon from...
Brandon Urie from Panic at the Disco.
Yes, I blanked on the name because I'm not a huge fan of them.
We'll get into that eventually because I've got some stuff with that. So,
all right.
But anyway, go ahead. What were you gonna say about Brandon Urie?
Oh no, it's just that he was a guest vocalist on this song.
He was, and this was about the same time that their first album, A Fever You Can't Sweat Out, came out. And it's funny because I remember like talking to people. I had not heard Panic at the Disco. I was like, what do they sound like? And somebody goes, well, he sounds exactly like Patrick Stump.
He really did back then.
But the music is different. Yeah, like so much. Because I had to really listen to when he came in because it all sounded seamless.
And what's funny is 3 years later when he's guesting on Folly Ado, you can hear the differences between them clear as day. But in 2005, yes, they sounded like the same person.
Yes, they did. They sounded exactly the same. But I do feel like it's a good little cameo for him on this album, a good way for them to get their band name out there. Because, I was curious about Panic at the Disco. Like I said, I hadn't heard them, but I knew the name Brandon Urie, and I knew the band Panic at the Disco. So it just took me a little bit of time to catch up and familiarize myself with the band. But this was a good little launching point for them. And I feel like I don't want to credit Fall Out Boy with their success, but I feel like it's part of the reason that they were as successful as they were.
They for sure opened the door for them.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw them open for Fall Out Boy on the Save Rock and Roll tour. So it was still a band. It wasn't just Brandon. They were really good live. I will say they were far better live than I expected them to be.
That dude knows how to entertain. I'll give him that. Like, he knows how to put on a show. I've never seen them live, but I've watched. I went through a big panic kick a long time ago, and so I was watching one of their concerts live on YouTube, and I was like, man, this dude knows how to put on a show for sure. Like, he knows what's up. And so funny. So real quick, like, I guess this is like a little bit of a, I could save this for later, but I want to tell it now. I actually met his sister a while ago, and I was like, so is he like a crazy person or is he just like awesome? She's like, he just likes to entertain, like, and he's really good at it. Like, that's cool. That's
all really right.
Cool. But anyway, all right, that's 7 minutes in heaven. What do you got next for us, Jason?
Okay, so my last one is probably the most polarizing song on the album, and probably one of my favorite songs on the album, if not my favorite song on the album. I'm going with I've Got a Dark Alley and a Bad Idea That Says You Should Shut Your Mouth, parenthetical, Summer Song. Patrick Stump hates this song.
Does he really?
Yes, he hates this song. And supposedly the song is so personal for Pete, they'll never play it live.
Wow. How did it end up on the album then?
I don't know.
Because it's just that good?
It is really good. And I don't know why people hate this song.
I don't know either. Like, this song had me hooked from the first time I heard it because it's just different enough, but at the same time, it's really catchy. And Summer Song is the perfect parenthetical for it because, like, it's such a great song to drive around with your windows down. Like, this was the first song I ever heard that I was introduced to the concept of a summer song that was like this. Like, oh, yes. But anyway, go ahead. I'm sorry.
To me, it's their ultimate underdog song.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this is the peak of that whole idea with them, because they write great songs about underdogs. My God, that first line, joke me something awful, just like kisses on the necks of best friends.
Well, quotation and friends marks. Is in quotes, yeah.
Oh, and the second pre-chorus of "I'm hopelessly hopeful, you're just hopeless enough." Like, man, that's like you either you felt it or you know people, like it's identifiable in a way that other Fall Out Boy songs aren't always identifiable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, and "We Can Fake It for the Airwaves, Force Our Smiles, Baby Half Dead." I think that's, I don't know, like I feel like, I don't know if we've all been in a relationship where it's like you put on a happy face in front of everybody, you know, essentially faking it for the airwaves, you know, but like, is this the one you're telling me about when you were in a relationship that went on way longer than?
No.
Oh, okay. Okay. So for those of you who don't know, Jason was telling me about a relationship that went on way longer than it should have. And I feel like this is it because I mean, I've been there before, and it's not necessarily keeping somebody on the hook, but you're just going through the motions for a while. And then you're like, finally, you're just like, you know what? Whatever. You know, and it ends. But yeah, and you're forcing the smiles, and then comparing myself to everyone else around me. And part of it is that you feel like when you're younger, you feel like you have to be in a relationship sometimes. You know, like at the time that was going on, I had three other friends who had girlfriends, and I was kind of like, well, everybody else has a girlfriend, I should just keep mine. You know?
Yeah.
So
for me, that line hit home in another way.
Mm-hmm.
Like growing up, I'd be compared to like my cousin, or I'd be compared to this kid or that kid or someone similar. And like, you had like they were your rivals, even though you never had an issue with them. But for some reason, oh, this person's just like you. Like that hit home to me in that way. Like, always end up comparing yourself to someone else because for some reason you don't always feel good enough. And
yeah,
to know that Pete Wentz was talking about this when they were on the rocket ship to becoming one of the biggest bands ever, it makes it relatable. You can relate to this person because you get it to some degree.
Yeah. Yep. Exactly. I think that's a perfect description of that. I love it. All right. Last song here that we have. This was currently my favorite song on this album, and has been for a very long time. It's of all the gin joints in the world. At the time, I was not very, I guess, literate in classic cinema, I guess you should say. So at the time, I did not get the "of all the gin joints in the world." To me, it was a reference to Out Cold.
Which was referencing the actual movie Casablanca.
The entire movie is it's a recreation of Casablanca, and I didn't know that at the time, but now I understand, so I get it when he says of all the ski towns, or of all the bars and all the ski towns in Alaska, that's a take on "of all the gin joints in the world" from Casablanca. And now that I know that, I can appreciate it a little bit better. But no, this is an outstanding song. The chorus is so funny. "Turn off the lights and turn off the shyness, because all of our moves will make up for the silence." This partially inspired a song that my friend and I wrote called "The Unheard Sounds of Making Love in the Dark."
There we go.
Which, I mean, to say that this album inspired a lot of that unrecorded album that we put together, like, is an understatement, because there's even a line on this album, I can't remember if it's in one of the songs that we covered or not, where it says, "I hope you sing along and you steal a line." He literally took that line and put it in one of our songs. I was like, I don't think he meant like seriously do. He's like, well, I just did. So here we are. Anyway,
this to me is the most poppy song on the album.
Yeah,
musically, lyrically, maybe not lyrically, but musically, it's definitely the most poppy song on the album. Mm-hmm. Okay, I would be remiss if I didn't talk about this, the second part of the chorus, and "oh, the way your makeup stains my pillowcase." We're all thinking the same thing, right? Like, this isn't someone sleeping over and keeping their makeup on, right? Like, this is far dirtier than,
okay. Yeah.
Because the notes on "Genius," it's got to be written by someone who's young. That's all I'm saying. Someone who maybe doesn't understand.
Yeah, no, I don't think they understand that. now that I look at it. But I mean, it could be one of those. It could be a, like, I don't want to say a double entendre, maybe like a triple, quadruple or something, because there are obviously layers to the lines. We've established this. There are layers to the lyrics that Pete Wentz writes. And you know, it could be that. It could be like the note says, the stains that she has left on his life. I don't know, but
I'm just saying, to me, sex is an overarching theme on this album, whether people realize it or not.
Yes, it is. And it's overt. It's not even, I don't even know if overt's the right word, but it's not, he's not coy about it.
No.
So,
and you know, whatever he was writing about stuff he was experiencing. So like, this has to be tied into their burgeoning fame, and where they were going in life. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, and the thing that's funny about that is that, like, you look at a lot of, I mean, Sophomore Slump or Come Back to the Earth, this is their sophomore album. You look at a lot of sophomore albums, and this is kind of the path that it takes. Yeah, they talk about their burgeoning fame that, you know, well, we hit it on the previous one. Now this is what we're dealing with. You know, and you do see it a lot in this entire album. It is an overarching theme. But we've gone long, Jason. Let's go ahead and wrap up here. I think we can both agree on the rating for this album.
Yeah, I agree.
On our essential pop punk scale. For those of you not watching on YouTube, a 100 is just popped up on the screen. And we agree. I mean, we both agree that this album is near perfection from start to finish. It's what brought a lot of people into the genre, I feel like, because it was more relatable musically. The lyrics, even if you don't know what they're about, they make you feel something, I feel like. You know?
Yes, I agree.
That you might not know exactly what it is, but there's definitely something there that you can identify with.
Yeah, this was an excellent album, start to finish. And seeing them perform this album live was really cool, too.
Oh, I'm so jealous. I never got to.
Oh, man. So, sidebar story here before we wrap up.
Go for it.
The relationship you threw out there of mine that we had talked about. her and I went to see them on this tour. It was them and All American Rejects and Hawthorne Heights, who I can't stand. And I know you like them, and I'm sorry. I'll never forget. So this is 3 years after I graduated high school. And there was a hot math teacher when I was in high school.
I think we all have. There was at least one in every school.
So who was drunk in my section at the Fall Out Boy show flirting with me in front of my girlfriend at the time?
Wait, how old were you?
I would have been 21.
Okay.
And the hot math teacher was like in our section behind me, like grabbing my shoulders, rubbing my shoulders, talking to me, and it was very weird.
It would be.
I'm like, I had you for math 3 years ago.
So funny.
I even said that. So
what did she say to that?
Like, no, you didn't. Water under the bridge, Jason. No, you definitely you taught me math.
Taught me something, that's for sure.
Hi-o. All right, I'm done. So funny.
But anyway, let us know what you think about this album. Do you agree with us that it is a 100? Again, that's Fall Out Boys from Under the Cork Tree. Reach out to us on Twitter at Punk Popcast, or me personally on the screen here on YouTube at Jojo Cornrow, and Jason.
I'm at X. Jason Dag X.
Yes, very good. I love it. Let us know what you think. Reach out to us. And we will definitely respond to you. Thanks again for joining us for Fall Out Boys from Under the Cork Tree. We will get with you next week.